Your Holiness, Excellencies, Most Venerable Dhammaratana, President of Standing Committee of the International Forum on Global Faith and Culture, Master Chiang Bucheng, President of the Organizing Committee of the Forum, Honorable religious and faith leaders, distinguished delegates and friends. On behalf of the International Council for the Day of Vesak and the International Association of Buddhist Universities, I'm pleased to be here to express our support to Most Venerable Dhammaratana and Master Chiang Bucheng for setting up the forum, International Forum of Global Faith and Culture. This a brave initiative needed support from all of us. And I think that you share my views, that's why you are here. Because the world is in need of this kind of common platform for interfaith dialogue. We have many kinds of international forum, but a few of them are interfaith forum or platform for interfaith dialogues, which aim at promoting tolerance, mutual respect, and cooperation. I think you agree with me when listening to opening address by Most Venerable Dhammaratana and Master Chiang Bucheng just finished. Although it mentioned about Buddhist teaching, but it is in Mahayana tradition. Tathagata Kappa Tao Yin Yang Chinese tradition. And when he mentioned that our body may be taken as obstacle to soar over to heaven, that reminds me of statement by Socrates in the West, Greek philosopher. Why he was not afraid of death? Because he found that his body is a prison that contains his mind, his wisdom. And he could not live in the world of wisdom in the heaven because of the body. Why afraid of death? Something like that. I mentioned this because here we are to learn from each other, to appreciate our difference and similarity. Difference make us interesting. Similarity make our unity in view and action. So both differences of faith and religions are valuable to learn, and we have to learn with spirit of mutual respect. That's why we are thankful to you, Master Chiang Bucheng, Venerable Dhammaratana, to create this platform for making a better world. Very good word. I like that. And the main theme of the conference is world crisis and spiritual solutions. The nature of crisis are interconnected. It cannot be solved by one nation or one religion alone, because the cause of the crisis are interconnected. Paticca Samubbada, it comes from different causes. And it affects not only one country. World crisis has a widespread impact on many countries. That's why we have to join hands. We have to pull our wisdom from science. For example, in the case of climate change, I participated in the COP15 in Copenhagen, and later COP26 online. We learned a lot from scientists about the danger of carbon dioxide, the increase of temperature they want to limit to 1.5. Very difficult to understand without help from scientists. And for ethics, it's up to us, religious leaders, to provide the framework of thinking that is the way we are doing together. Now, I think this conference is organized at the juncture of history, when we just pass over, not finish, the pandemic COVID-19. We know how this global crisis affects our life of people in the world. And we can learn from this lesson that, from the COVID-19, that we need to work together, to do something together, to pour over our wisdom and effort to meet the challenge of the world crisis. So I would quote from the Buddha, Samakkanang tapo sukho, joy efforts of the like-minded people lead to happiness. So I am happy to be here among friends from different religious and faith traditions. I would like to take this opportunity to express my congratulations to Most Venerable Dhammaratana, to Master Chang Bucheng and Organizing Committee for hosting this international forum in a peaceful and prosperous land called Singapore. May this wonderful forum be of great success. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. In the morning session, we discuss about creating this platform. So that I have mentioned in the morning that the aim of international forum on global faith is to create a platform for dialogue which is constructive, cooperative interaction between people of different faith and spiritual beliefs. The aim is to increase tolerance and cooperation. Using the word of former minister of Singapore is harmony. How we achieve harmony in thought, words, and action in this platform. That is the main aim. Just harmony in thought is called tolerance. Tolerance is who controls it? My or you? Tolerance, I take it from Declaration of Principles of Tolerance proclaimed by UNESCO in 1995. That should be our code of conduct here, to arrive at tolerance in accordance with the principles proclaimed by UNESCO. UNESCO defined tolerance as respect, acceptance, and appreciation of the rich diversity of our world's cultures, our forms of expression, and ways of being human. This is an example of tolerance at a colorful meeting. Try to understand, appreciate the values of the other. In the morning, we appreciate the dragon dance to welcome us. We, with patience, reason to each other, try to understand the values of from other religious and spiritual faith. So the aim is not just tolerance, appreciation, that is in thought, because tolerance is about the thought, but what we need more from this platform is cooperation or harmony in words and action. How can we arrive at harmony or cooperation? We have to find a common goal. In spite of our differences in beliefs and values sometimes, we overcome our differences, try to arrive at the same goal. For example, in this meeting, we want to fight against the challenge in world crisis. Or in other case, we aim at working together for achieving SDGs, Sustainable Development Goals set by the United Nations. So with this goal, we work together to achieve that. So now we come to cooperation in terms of global crisis. Global crisis need our forum to work together. Oh. By world crisis, I mean events that have widespread and far-reaching impacts, affecting multiple regions, countries, or even continents simultaneously. In the morning, I talk about the spread of pandemic coronavirus. It's an example of world crisis. But the thing that we need to meet the challenge here is that the nature of world crisis is interconnected. It includes social, economic, and environmental problems in a global scale. one nation alone or even religious or spiritual faith alone cannot meet this challenge. We have to come together, doing something together. That's why we need to prioritize our projects. Which kind of world crisis that we want to combat to meet the challenge? Because there are so many issues related to world crisis, depending on your geography. In Western Europe, your main concern will be war and conflict. In Africa, it is about economic inequalities. Or the whole world facing climate change. So many things to do. We have to devote our limited resources to particular goal, which one that you want to deal with. Pandemics like coronavirus, health emergencies, or economic crisis, or conflict and security crisis, climate change, environmental crisis. Which one that you find is in the list of your priority that you want to deal with? To respond to the crisis, we have to pull together, that is contribution from religious and spiritual system that we have with us here. First, I think we need combination, or I use the term integration of the wisdom. From our experience in convening international conference in the Day of Vesak in Bangkok this year, we invite the scholars to contribute how to meet the challenge of the world crisis by means of wisdom. Wisdom from your teachers, wisdom from the scripture, from the text, wisdom from your experience, from your insight, so that we can find the proper strategies to deal with crisis. So we may like to listen to your quotations from Bibles, from Al-Quran, from Tripitaka, from any source, and interpretation of your master, teacher, so that we can see the total picture of wisdom. What I mean by wisdom is, in Buddhism, it's panya. Panya, or wisdom, defined as ability to realize inner qualities and relationship that is inside. When you have insight into the true nature of things, that is one aspect of panya, it pierces through the superficial clothes to the inner, to the core of the truth. That is one aspect of panya, or wisdom. Another thing is to see the connection of cause and effect, past, present, and future, so that you can predict your future event by means of panya, so that you can have a prevention of the world crisis. So when we focus on using panya, or wisdom, to solve the world crisis, it means we adopt a holistic approach to the problems. It is not from one particular angle that we want to deal with it. We have to look around to see the root cause of the problem, how to deal with it.
In our tradition, it is called Paticca Samuppada. Paticca Samuppada is very important concept in Buddhism, Theravada and Mahayana. It translated as dependent origination. This law of dependent origination can be summarized as if A exists, B exists. If A ceases to exist, B also ceases to exist. If B representing world crisis, it comes from A. Because of A, you have a crisis. That is, in this formula, if A, then B. If not A, then not B. This is Paticca Samuppada formula. How we apply this formula to solve the world crisis? This is an example for you, so that you can pull up your wisdom from your tradition, from science, together. The Four Noble Truths, starting from Dukkha is B, crisis. We recognize that there is a world crisis, that is Dukkha, or suffering, is B. B comes from A, that is Samudaya, is a cause of crisis. How can we solve the crisis? Is it possible? We create hope, expectation together, hope for a better world. When you talk of we come together to make a better world, it is the third truth, Nirodha. Possibility of reaching the goal. The goal is there. The better world without crisis, without number one, by eradicating number two. But how? That is practice. Number four, Makkha, is a path, is a way, is a method. Actionable step leading to cessation of crisis. That is action. After we aim at a goal, we work together in harmony to realize the goal by means of Makkha method. And that's why we need your contribution from your tradition. So that is number one, wisdom. Number two is cooperation to compassion. Although you have wisdom, you have everything in your stockpile, but you may be content with what you have. So what stimulate or move you to come to this platform to work together? Because of your mind, empathy, compassion. You avoid making war because your mind is full of compassion or mercy. So in the preamble of your UNESCO constitution, it said, since wars begin in the minds of men, it is in the minds of men that the defense of peace must be constructed. So religious practice, religious teaching paved the way for peace by developing mind, virtue within our mind. So in the world today, they talk about compassion. Develop compassion through meditation. Mindfulness, sati, even pray or chanting together. This is the method that we are going to present and work together, pray together in spirit of harmony. Like in the morning, what is it that show in Singapore, they have common prayer. Something like that we meditate, we develop mindfulness, pray together to purify our mind of greed, hatred, and ignorance
which is the cause of different conflicts.
You know, in 2014, Time magazine put it in the cover. It's called Mindful Revolution. When the in Western world they turn to practicing mindfulness. Mindfulness comes from different traditions, not only Buddhism, in Hinduism, yoga, TM, anything. So if the world practice mindfulness, you see how to purify the mind of bad element. And that is religious practice can help to prevent world crisis. I think the most important is harmony in action. Once we discover or we find the solution, how to arrive at the goal to solve the world crisis. It is said in Pali, Sukha Sankhasa Samakhi, unity of the group is happiness. If we work together and like my people, then that will lead to making up projects of the same purpose. In your decoration, you must find some project of the same purpose to eradicate suffering due to some kind, some issue of world crisis. If you like to deal with economic crisis or climate change or even war and conflict, that is, we forget our differences. Quote from the wisdom from our text, from our teacher, that motivate people to purify their mind and work together towards the goal, that would be fruitful for this platform. For example, in the year 2000, I was one of 1,000 religious and spiritual leaders met at the United Nations in New York. Although that meeting may be forgotten nowadays, but one thing that I have never forgotten is the declaration in one sentence: no more war in the name of religion. This is very strong statement echo in my mind. Although after this year there was a conflict in the south of Thailand, we the Buddhist majority confirm this statement. Religion should not be abused to wage war or start conflict. We the Buddhists will not allow Buddhism to be a tool of the conflict by politicians. They may have a political agenda in their mind, but don't drag religion, Buddhism, or other religion into the field of conflict. We still maintain this position in Thailand. So our voice representing soft power, not hard power. Religious leaders do not have armies to maintain its position, but because of our belief system, our followers, our Dhamma, our culture, we can assert our soft power to attract people to the field of peace, culture of peace, not culture of war. That is our, I think, our power. And we have to realize this power. And this power cannot be used alone. We have to come together, voice our concern, our strategy. Then it becomes soft power to be aware by those who want to start conflict. For example, you know, last month, the
Secretary General of the Organization of Islamic Cooperation, you know. He's Secretary General of Muslim country, 57 Muslim country, visit Thailand. And he paid a personal visit to my temple. I invite religious leaders for the discussion how to maintain our religious values to maintain peace in our land. So why they come to my temple? Because of our soft power. During the Vesak celebration, your prime minister paid a visit to my temple. Prime Minister of Sri Lanka, the current prime minister. What is it about the soft power? We represent the voice of conscience so that we spread this message of peace through declaration or whatever that is constructive and it is helpful. In terms of world crisis, I believe that prevention sometimes is better than cure. Prevention of conflict before it arises, prevention of global warming before it becomes it reaches tipping point of no return. And if that is very necessary. I show you that one thing, one strategy is to contribute our support for the realization of 17 goals for sustainable development. These 17 goals can be summarized and give priority to just 5 P's. You see, 5 P's standing for number one, people, culture, peace, number two, economic prosperity. Number three, planet, that is environment. The foundation of the other 3 P is peace. Without peace, you cannot have human right, that is for people. You cannot have economic prosperity, and you cannot preserve environment. So peace is the foundation of other kinds of sustainable development. But how is that possible? Because of the other P, partnership. Partnership is the key word for the United Nations to realize 16 goals. Partnership is the goal number 17, the last one. If we interpret in our movement, it is about strengthening cooperation between religion and faith, using a shared vision for defining that collaborative way forward. So collaboration among religions and faith is a partnership to realize our goal, that is to meet the challenge of world crisis or to realize the goal, achieve the goal of sustainable development. I hope that will be in our agenda. So I myself representing Thailand to participate in the Interfaith Conference on Religions and the Sustainable Development Goals, SDG, in the Vatican before coronavirus spread, the pandemic. I listened to speech given to us by the Pope. I contribute in the interfaith meeting there at the Vatican with the support of the UN body in Geneva. We look forward that all the faith-based organization, FBO, to come forward to support SDG from the point of view of religion and faith. After meeting there, I have a religious dialogue with the Pope in Thailand. See? It means I end with this statement. No one is big enough to achieve the goals alone. No one is too small to help achieve the goals. No one is capable of solve the world crisis alone. We have to work together in harmony. Thank you very much.